Hello everyone, and you're here with me for another episode of The Heartbeat of Sri Lanka. And today we have with us a very unique character when it comes to doing business. The chairman of Lassana Flora Private Limited, Dr. Lasantha Malawige. How are you, Dr. Lasantha?
I'm very well, thank you.
So tell me, to what do you owe your success?
Difficult question. So many things. So many things. I would say the I would put my family first. The without my sister, my parents, my wife, and then my second family is my team. The I consider them as also part of my family, the Lassana Flora family. And we have we are not a big corporate as such. We have 250 people with us, and I think I would put my close family and the family next, that is Lassana Flora family, to whatever success we have achieved. I don't think in terms of business, I don't think it's a major success, because it's like the but in terms of making a difference, which is is my vision, or the reason to do business, making a difference in the society, we have been very successful.
So tell me, you are a specialist doctor by profession, and yet you run a business that is provides floral arrangements to people. How did this all begin? Tell me how it all began back in the day when you were still in university.
Yeah, I think that is an interesting story, Sachita. When I was in the Colombo Medical School, and the I wanted to do something, and the I was exploring different things what I could do, and then I realized that I had creative part in me. I'm a creative person. That is what, like, you know, the art, craft, such things I used to love in school, and at home I used to do little things. And I thought I also wanted to create a brand, create a business. So I thought this is a good area to get in. And I started very small with the one member of staff, and I used to go to lectures during the day, and started doing bridal bouquets and decorations in the evening. So it started very small.
So you did them by yourself?
Most of it at the beginning, with one or two, initially we had one member, and it gradually grew to current 250 people. But the initially I used to do everything on my own.
How was it back then? I mean, something we hear from most Sri Lankan students is you can't manage university with work, you can't manage, leaving apart work, this is doing your own business.
Yes.
How do you manage it while being in medical faculty? I mean, leave apart any other
yes.
degree.
Yes, I agree with you, Sachita, because the medical training is considered the most difficult and most involved, and in the process I learned good time management. And in the medical schools, the exams are really tough. If you fail an exam, you have to do it after a couple of months, and if you fail that again, you'll have to do it on the following year. And at least in Colombo Medical Faculty, it used to be that at least 70 to 80% fail at least one exam during this 5.5 years. And I never failed an exam.
Wow. That's, I think, an achievement to talk about.
No, not really. Because I knew if I fail an exam, I'm losing a lot of
time
doing the repeat. So I was very careful not to fail an exam. And also I was careful not to put too much effort also, because when I know that I can get 60%, I will stop there. I won't try and go for 75% for the paper. So by doing that trying to balance the two, I learned good time management skills, and then I developed better skills while managing the business outside the country, while being outside the country. As you said, after graduating, I wanted to become a specialist in my field of interest. And when I went to UK for that, that was a major decision to be away from a growing business for 5 years was a big challenge. And then from 2004 until 2009, I was in Oxford doing my PhD and the specialist training, and it was a tough time. But there I learned better
management skills.
And my sister also helped me during that period, which had been which was critical actually. Without her support, I wouldn't have done that. And that's how it all
started,
yes.
So tell me, why did you think of doing something along the lines of floral arrangements? I mean, you were in a medical college. You could have easily done something like a pharmaceutical business or something along those
yes.
lines. I mean, there's so
yes.
many businesses
yeah.
Related to
yes.
medicine. But
yes.
you chose something completely different, something completely new to you
yes.
as well.
Yeah.
Why did you choose this, and how did you manage to succeed in that part?
Yes, initially, there's a long story in this, which is a story that evolved with time. As I said, I thought I'm creative. I knew that I'm creative. So this is a business that you could use your creativity. So I had the advantage in getting into this. The second thing was I realized that there is a big vacuum in service delivery in the country, and which is important driving force for me to do well or to try and set an example in service delivery. This is our motive in running this business. It's like this: you'd appreciate that if I say our service delivery in this country. I think we have to admit, many times we have to compromise and there is a mismatch between what is promised and what is delivered. And so I wanted to, that was especially so in this industry. If we are to get a proper set of decor or flowers for an event, those days it was very expensive, and still you are not assured of good quality. And so I wanted to make the flower arrangements, the wedding decorations, event decorations, affordable to everyone, and also to deliver what is promised. So as a team, we believe that disappointing a customer is a crime, and as a team, all of us are committed to make our customer happy, delighted. But we also have committed this crime, and we continue to commit this crime sometimes, because things don't happen the way we wanted all the time. So with all the efforts, with all the motives, It does happen sometimes, but we've been able to maintain very high the standards, very high standards. One thing that we closely monitor is customer satisfaction, and we monthly targets are based on customer satisfaction. Not on volumes. Volumes is subsidiary, not an important thing for us. So sometimes, some months we manage to get 100% satisfaction from all the customers. Sometimes there are a couple of disappointments, but we learn from these mistakes. And the main motive is I want to set an example in service delivery, and it's a long journey, but we have. We have achieved something, but much more to be achieved.
Now, when you started off, you didn't have any background in flower business.
Yes.
How did you manage to find suppliers? How did you manage to deal with these suppliers and get what you want and go in and deliver them to your customers? How did you manage to do that?
Sachita, it's a struggle, and it continues to be a struggle. And I like to struggle. When I started, we did not have our own farms, which we have now. But I went to Norelia, and with the help of the Flower Growers Association, I met with villagers, and. I spoke to them, I told them, we have wonderful weather conditions to grow flowers, and do it as a profession, and we will buy back your flowers. And also I made a promise to them that we will never import flowers, which we have kept for last 18 years. And we don't import flowers. And then we realized the very small growers find it difficult to supply us because their quantities are very small. Then we started our own collecting center, so that even a very small grower who grows little, like maybe 200 Jebra flowers, they can still supply us. So they can supply it to our collecting center, which the freezer trucks go every other day and collect it from the collecting center. And that is the next evolution in the supply chain management. And then we realized some of the varieties, for example, lilies, some of the chrysanthemums and freesias, these need technology, and these flowers need advanced care. And this cannot be done with small growers. So we went into the growing business as well. And we currently have three farms, the one in Belihullo, another one in Tapetikula and Norelia. In these three locations, we grow different varieties of flowers, because these three places are in three different altitudes. With the three different altitude, we can grow different varieties of flowers. And now, not only these farms and our collecting center provide our floral requirement, and also we do wholesales. We supply hotels and the other florists, and we have also started exports. So we export the flowers grown in our farms as well.
So now, apart from just being a floral delivery service, you all also have branched out into various other avenues. Tell me a bit about that.
Yeah, so we have vertically integrated our business to grow in, as I said, and also our delivery business, like people want flowers and gifts delivered to their houses, because when you want to send some flowers to someone on a special day, if you are to go to the florist, pick it up and then deliver, that's that is going to cost more than the flowers and time. So we have this delivery service. This is one of the best in the country, and we operate in three different ways. One is like, no one could place the order with our showrooms. The other one is the call center. We have a dedicated call center where people could order over the phone, and we have these catalogs distributed among offices. And the third thing, and the most important thing, is the online business. And online business is growing very fast. And in the online business, we are the first to introduce the specific time delivery in the country. It used to be when you order something, you are likely to get it on that day.
Yeah.
Or the following day, or after a couple of days. But we are what we are offering is specific time delivery. We have the largest free delivery network in the country. In Colombo district, most of the Colombo district up to Nigambu, and from south up to Moratuwa is free. We deliver free within the normal delivery hours, that is from 9 to 5. But if it is a specific time delivery, as I said, you can select your delivery time slot at a nominal price. So the online business, we have also included other products. It's not just flowers that we deliver. We have our own bakery. We produce a beautiful range of cakes and sweets, cupcakes and stuff like that. And we have other accessory, like, you know, the soft toys, other toys and stuff, the other gift items. We directly import and sell through the online portal. Because it's easy for someone to combine a soft toy or some other gifts with a flower arrangement.
So I've also heard that you are the president for the South Asian Society for Sexual Medicine. How do you tackle that along with a business while also practicing at hospitals?
I think, Sajit, it's a challenge. It's not easy. As I said before, I'm used to juggle the two. I've been practicing or learning continuously the better time management, and it's a bit of a struggle, but I enjoy it.
I don't think any of us will understand how you do it.
We need another discussion on that.
So tell me, getting down to the last question.
Yeah.
What sort of advice would you have to give to youngsters? Firstly, those who want to start a business in this field, in the field of floral arrangements. And then secondly, someone who wants to be an entrepreneur in Sri Lanka.
Yeah, the two questions. The first, how to start a business in this industry. Now it has evolved over the last couple of years. It has become more professional, more competitive, and now they have a better opportunity than what we had to do it better. One thing is we have started our floral designing academy. And it's mostly the people who follow this course are people who want to start their own business. And now we are taking the 10th batch. And those who have followed the course have started the floral businesses throughout the country, and they are doing very well. And I would recommend that. And even in that course, one thing I tell, at the beginning, I meet each batch on the first day and the last day of the course. And one important thing I say is try to do your best in whatever you do. So the never disappoint a customer and try to keep your promise always. So if you practice these basic principles, you will you are likely to succeed. And the second thing, second question, what advice I would give to a budding entrepreneur? The I think you need to have a vision. You have to, as I said before, my driving force is to make a difference. The if you have a vision to make something happen in whatever the field, and come with that, then the because entrepreneurs are the people who make the world different. The their contribution is often not appreciated enough in Sri Lanka. The because even in schools, the you are taught to become a doctor
or engineer
or like a, take up
do a conventional job.
Yes, and the and we are also trying to depend on our parents and the government and all the we don't try to be our own and try when I was going to medical school, I was making money for my education, even though my parents could afford it. The I think my advice is the have a vision in life, and as a society we need to encourage entrepreneurship, and encouraging entrepreneurship, I think the country can prosper much faster.
Thank you so much for your valuable time and those valuable words of advice. It was a pleasure talking with you this evening.
It was a pleasure talking to you too. Thank you.
Thank you. That's it from today's Heartbeat of Sri Lanka. What we have for you is always have a vision in life and always remember that customer satisfaction comes number one. With that, we wrap up for today and we'll see you in another 2 weeks.